Good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for inviting me to speak about a new interesting and effective technology to treat dry eye disease. I'll share with you my experience, results, and clinical indications. This is the definition of dry eye, and as you can see, dry eye is a complex disease. And this is the reason why sometimes it's very difficult even to make a correct diagnosis and prescribe an effective therapy. What we normally try to do during diagnostic exams is to classify our patient into one of these two groups: patients with evaporative dry eye or patients with hyposecretive dry eye. Sometimes it is not easy, and a large number of these dry eye patients have a mixed situation with both evaporative and hyposecretive dry eye. These are the tests that we usually perform to classify our dry eye patients: evaluation of the osmolarity of the tear film to share dry eye patients from not dry eye patients, the NIVUT, not invasive breakup time, for information about the quality of the tear film, the thickness of the lipid layer through interferometry, meibography to check meibomian glands morphology, tear meniscus height in place of Schirmer test because not correlated to corneal sensitivity, sometimes also the Fernin test, the staining test of the cornea and conjunctiva with fluorescein to look for suffering or damaged areas, the evaluation of tear film distribution by the slit lamp, the questionnaire like the Ocular Surface Disease Index for the evaluation of subjective symptoms, the inflammation test or inflammatory test to look for the marker of chronic inflammation such as MMP9 biomarker. In case of hyposecretive dry eye, we will find high osmolarity, low or normal NIVUT values, a normal lipid layer thickness, and the meibomian glands have a normal or only slightly alterated morphology. The tear meniscus value is less than 0.2 mm, and the inflammatory test can be negative or positive, and the corneal staining usually shows impairment of the ocular surface at the cornea level. In case of evaporative dry eye, we will have high osmolarity, low values of NIVUT, a thin lipid layer, and a variable meibography, but usually with more or less important alterations. The height of the lacrimal meniscus is normal, and the inflammation test can be positive or negative based on the degree of severity. The staining test shows an alteration, especially at the conjunctival level. In case of mixed dry eye, we will have a combination of the characteristics of both. Symptoms are usually prominent, and the patient therefore tends to complain a lot. In case of mixed dry eye, we have a deficiency of the lacrimal gland associated with a deficiency of the meibomian glands, with therefore an excessive evaporation and a poor tear meniscus value. These are the therapies available to treat dry eye disease: artificial tears with different constituents inside, such as hyaluronic acid or fatty acids, topical steroids, cyclosporine, accurate eyelid hygiene, antibiotics, especially tetracycline if associated with blepharitis or blepharoconjunctivitis, warm patches, night ointments, omega-3 supplements or probiotics, plugs and instrumental therapies. Rexonai is one of the latest devices available to treat dry eye disease. Rexonai uses QMR technology to effectively treat all types of dry eye, hypersecretive and evaporative, by acting on both the lacrimal and meibomian glands. It is a non-invasive and well-tolerated technology. It's a comfortable treatment and allows to obtain a long and sometimes permanent reduction or resolution of symptoms. QMR technology, that means quantum molecular resonance, uses low voltage current to act on cells and tissues with a regenerative effect. Several studies show that QMR technology is already well known for tissue regeneration, acting at the DNA level and stimulating metabolism and stem cells. This is the reason why the QMR technology is already used in some other specialties of medicine, such as physiotherapy and aesthetic medicine. It is used also for pain therapy and for the healing of ulcers, wounds, and burns. This is a very interesting study on QMR treatment for the healing of wounds on the extremities of the limbs, wounds that were struggling to heal. This study shows that after QMR treatment, there was an increase in granulation tissue, a reduction in pain and inflammatory cells, with a consequent acceleration of the healing process. Two images of the ulcer before and after the QMR treatment. But why did I decide to use the QMR treatment to treat dry eye? Because it is a technology that has already been used for years in other medical specialties with success and without side effects. Because it is already used in dermatology and aesthetic medicine for the complete healing of wounds, because it can lead to complete healing of dry eye and not only to the improvement of symptoms, since it acts at the tissue level both on the lacrimal gland and on the meibomian glands. Because it can be used on all types of dry eye. Because to date, no side effects or adverse events have been documented, and because several studies have been published that demonstrate the safety and efficacy of the treatment. Several studies are being conducted also here in Italy, in Europe, and in other parts of the world. Candidates for this treatment are patients with hypersecretive, evaporative, or mixed dry eye with meibomian gland dysfunction. They are patients who have immunological or endocrinological diseases, who have a poor tear meniscus and/or a thin lipid layer. They usually use steroids or cyclosporine and abuse artificial tears or tear gels. In this study, we treated 93 patients with hypersecretive or mixed dry eye with Rexon eye. We followed the treatment protocol, which includes 4 sessions, 1 per week for 4 consecutive weeks, and each lasting 20 minutes. We examined the patients 1 month, 3, 6, and 12 months after treatment. We evaluated non-invasive breakup time, lipid layer thickness, tear meniscus height, the questionnaire, the ocular surface disease index, the inflammation test with inflammatory test, the mammography, before therapy and at each follow-up visit. This is a table that shows the results obtained with the first 6 patients treated. But increasing the number of patients, we had the same results that have been maintained over time. In summary, we found an improvement of symptoms, an increase in the thickness of the lipid layer and tear meniscus, an improvement in the values of NIBUT, and a decrease in inflammation. Over time, we have also found an improvement in the morphology of the meibomian glands associated with their better functionality. In conclusion, also with this technology, it is important to inform patients about the results that can be obtained and their timing. In fact, sometimes the improvements begin 1 or 2 months after the end of the treatment, but the improvements are significant, continue for a few months, and then stabilize after 6, 7 months. We had no side effects other than some redness for a few hours after the session, and the patient selection is less important than using other treatments. Sometimes in my clinical practice, I use this technology in combination with other to strengthen and accelerate results. Results that are, however, very good and promising for the future. I recommend only in some and selected cases a simultaneous approach with medicines or other devices to shorten the time necessary for the reduction of symptoms. I thank you for attention.